My little buddy there never lets me forget my tithe and offering. She comes looking for me. Well, just a few more years and she may be up here announcing it's time for tithe and offering. Amen. The Bible said train them up, right? Train them up. And that's more than bringing them to church. You can't get them all trained just bringing them to the house of God. You got to train them to live for God. I'm going to take you this morning to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, and begin reading in verse 16. I want to read three verses for you here this morning, very short verses, and I want to talk to you from these verses here today. He says, number one, rejoice evermore. He does not say rejoice in good times. He does not say rejoice when everything is going well in your life. He does not say rejoice just because all the bills are paid and everything is behind you. But he said rejoice forevermore. It is our objective to be rejoicing and to be praise and worship people for God. If we ever lose that objective, we're no different from any other group. It is a praise and worship and devotion and concentration to God that sets us aside. Then he said, pray without ceasing. Now, you know, you can't spend 24 hours a day at an altar kneeling down praying. But what he means is that there should always be a prayer on our mind. There should always be a thoughtfulness toward God on our mind. And if our mind veers away, it doesn't veer very far until he comes back to that place of giving our attention over to the Lord. Then he said, in everything give thanks. Now I know that it is not easy to give God thanks when your world is upside down. It is not easy to give thanks when somebody's knocking on your door and saying, if you don't have the money now, we're going to have to turn the water off. Or we're going to have to turn the electricity off because you're so many dollars over or so many months over and we can't let it go any further. And I know in those kind of times it is not easy to give thanks. But our obligation to God is never forget the fact that He is God. And whatever our situation is subject to change when we invite God into our presence. We've got to bring Him into our presence. And everything give thanks. For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. And the word concerning means that's the things that are important to you. The important things to you. What is important to you. It is the will of God that we give thanks for all those things that are important to us in our life. Let me talk to you briefly here this morning. Maybe that was a slip of a word. Maybe not too briefly, but a little bit briefly. On God's provision during adversity. That there is a provision that God has offered us during the time of diversity, our adversity. And adversities are going to come. There is no way that you're going to get through life without life bringing you some adverse situations. They're going to come. Adversity simply means it is time of difficulties and time of misfortunes. Misfortunes will come. Things you never expected. Things you were not looking for. They will come when you are not looking for them. When you get home today, if you want a real good setting of scripture to read from, to really find out how life is for men and women's lives, go to the book of Job and read chapter 14, 15, and 16. And let Job tell you something about what life is about. If you read verse 1 in chapter 14, he's going to say, man that is born of woman is a few days and full of trouble. If you go to the second verse, he's like a flower that is cut down, and he flees like a shadow and continues not. At your best, if you live to be 100, life is short. No matter how old you live, and some will live to be old, and some will not live to be old. But in all of that, we've got to have a time to give praise and respect and glory and honor to God. The Bible said in the fourth verse of that 14th chapter, who can bring a clean thing out of an unclean? And then he answers this, not one. There is not one person in the whole world that can take your messed up, corrupt, defiled life that is full of darkness and confusion and turn you around and make you what you ought to be The only person that can do that is God. There is no person that can change that person that you are in your life. So he said, seeing that your days are determined in verse 5, and the number of his months are with you, you are appointed in bonds until that he cannot pass, bonds that he cannot pass. Then a question comes. If a man dies and he wastes away, he said, man gives up the ghost, where is he? There's the question that you need to be asking yourself this morning. You've lived your life. You've come to the end. The end may be 14 years old. It could be 24, could be 54, could be 94. But when it finally comes, when the end of your life comes, the question is not what you have achieved, how many degrees you have, how many bank accounts you have, how nice your car is, how big your home is. None of that will matter then. As J.D. Rockefeller said, I would give all that I have for one more day of life. Just give me one more day to live. Because nothing in this world is worth losing out with God. So he said, the time will come that man will die and he'll waste away. And when he wastes away and he gives up the ghost, where is he? Not a person in the world can answer that question for you except you yourself. Have you been born again? Have you served God? Have you lived for God? Will you have come to the acknowledgement of the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 12 verse 7 when he said that the body will return back to the dust that it has come from and the spirit will return to God who gave it? And that spirit will one day come back and reunite with the body that you're wearing right now. Your body will be changed to an immortal status, but it's coming out. The believers are coming out of those graves. The last day my grandfather lived, he preached at the radio station and he preached about the resurrection. I understand that those that were with him said that day he kept looking out over the cemetery across the street and saying, one of these mornings those graves are going to open up. They're coming out. They're not going to stay in there. They're going to come out of there. And so when I look at that, a man that dies and the question that Job asked in Job 14:14, if a man dies, shall he live again? What I want to tell you here this morning, that you're going through times, and there'll be times in your life that you'll be far from death but feel like you're dying. You're going through pain. You're going through hurt. Maybe it is a time of a family breakup. Maybe it is a time of a sickness of a child or time of losing out with things. But I want to tell you, that regardless of what comes down the path for you, in all things you need to learn that I've still got to give God praise, glory, honor, and thanks, because I'm not praising him only for the good, I'm praising him for what he is and what he can do for all of our lives. Give him a big praise here this morning. There are provisions that God has made for us that we can count on to come into our life during times of adversity. And God's presence will show up in the pathway of our trouble. And God will show up there to be our strength, to be our help, to be our comforter. I know just recently I mentioned to you that my son Dwayne, Nate's dad, they just found out that he has another cancer that's alive in his body. And I'm telling you that when he wrote me and told me that, I felt like I was just going to throw up. I felt like and all of a sudden I had to step back and I had to say, God, this is you. This is you. I don't understand the misfortune. I don't understand the happenings, but I'm going to trust you that you know the best steps that we need to take in life. And we have to do that. Even when things don't come out the way we want them to come out, we have to believe that God has a master control of everything. So there's a provision during adverse situations in our life and adversities that come. There is a provision that's made by God. And the first provision that God made is he promised to protect us during bad and evil times. Now, I want to look at that word protection. Protection means he is my defense. He is my security. He's my safekeeping or my safeguard. And he's going to be there with me in bad times in my life. But what does it mean for God to be with me? Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13. See, everything is not going to go the way we wanted it to go. I would sit down and draw a map of where I wanted my life to go, but it doesn't always follow the path that I intended or the path that I wanted it to go on. But notice what Paul writes to the church, not to the unbeliever, not to the unsaved. He is talking to the church, which is at Corinth. And he says this, "There has no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man." Regardless of what you are going through this morning, regardless of what is happening in your life, you're not the only person there. There are thousands and millions of people around the world that's battling the same struggles that you're battling, but they're still holding on. They're not giving up. They're saying, God is bigger than my trial. God is bigger than my temptation. God is bigger than my failure. God is bigger than my sin. I'm going to turn it over to God and rely upon Him to be there for me. Amen. The temptations are common with man, but God is faithful. Look at that. My, that's a powerful, powerful statement. Regardless of what is going on, when you can't detect that God is anywhere in your life, when you can't see Him, you can't touch Him, you don't feel like you could pray and reach Him, and there comes times like that. There comes times that you pray and you feel like your prayer is being absorbed in the acoustics of the ceiling. There comes times that you feel like the wall just absorbs it and it's going no further. But in those moments, you've got to believe God is faithful whether I feel it or whether I don't. Whether I feel that God is there or not there, God is faithful. Whether I believe things are good or not, God is faithful. He's there faithful in my sickness. He's there faithful in my downfalls, my uprisings. There's no time that God isn't faithful. And He said, He will not allow you to be tempted above that which you are able. When you feel like that you're at the end of your rope and you just cannot hold on any longer, tie a knot and refuse to give up. Hang on. I'm in the cause of God. I'm serving God. I'm living for God. I refuse to give up on the call that God has put into my life. And that's not a call to the preaching. That's a call to serve Him and live for Him and do the things of the kingdom of God. He will never allow you to be tempted above what you are able. But here's what He said. He will with the temptation. He will with the temptation make a way for your escape that you will be able to bear it. Times of tests and trials will come to your life. They won't always come to your life. They don't come to your life to destroy you. They come to your life to restore you. They come to build you. They come to strengthen you. You can take a person, a man that's perfectly strong, and goes into some kind of a health failure and lays on a hospital bed for 30 or 60 days. Then when he gets up, he's not able even to walk. He's not able to maneuver around because he loses strength and loses mobility. And it's the same in the things of the kingdom of God. Unless God sends you into some things, those things that will strengthen you and encourage you to walk through and be faithful during times of trial in your life, you're going to find out that you're not strong enough to go through the next trial that you're there. When God sends you into a moment of trial, it's for a reason. It's for a reason. And I want to tell you this morning, whether I understand the reason or not, I understand this, that if it takes the trial to strengthen me to serve God and live for God, I want to go to heaven. I don't want to end up lost at the end of this life. And God, if it takes building the fire under me to make me what I need to be, set the flames out there and let me walk through that trial because I need strength from the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. I've got to learn to think positive and not negative. I've got to learn to not, it's not, God, why did you do this to me? Or God, why did you allow this? Or God, why did you? Some things are just called life. Amen. They're just called life. I've lived through life and I've had a wonderful life and I'm just so grateful for the blessings that life has brought me. God's brought me into your life and allowed you to be a part of my life, and I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for every person of God that I know and every man of God and every person of God in this church. I'm thankful for you. And I don't want to look at the bucket as half empty. I want to see the bucket as half full. I want to see what God is filling up, not what is falling away. I want to see where the glory of God is. And I want to tell you this morning that God says adversity is important for you and necessary for you in order for you to grow spiritually in the strength that he wants you to have. Our Father offers us protection by staying with us during the struggle. I'm walking through a struggle. I'm saying, God, why don't you relieve me from this? And God's saying, if I do, you'll fall in the next one. If I don't let you walk through the trial, I don't let you face the tribulation, I don't let you go through this, tomorrow a bigger adversity may come and you won't be able to handle it and have the strength to go through it. But what God does do, God shows up and he walks with us through the trial. Through the trial. He walks through the muddy waters. He walks through the moments of fire. He walks through the trial times. And God never leaves us and never forsakes us, but stays with us all the way, even to the end of the world. And we have an assurance from God that there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God. Let me read for you. Give God a big praise here in the house this morning, because God deserves that. Hallelujah. See, there's nothing that can separate us from the love of God. In the book of Romans, chapter 8, verse 38 and verse 39, he said, for I am persuaded. I'm totally confident. My mind is made up. I have already come to the conclusion. I have watched the past. I see the future. And I'm walking with God. And I am persuaded that neither death nor life. He's talking about things that will try to separate us from God. What he is saying is, because you die, it doesn't separate you from God. It simply takes you to the reward that you have lived for and served for, and you'd go to God who has saved you by his marvelous grace. Hallelujah. I'm persuaded neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, or things present or things to come. Neither height, he said, nor depth, nor any other creature is able to separate us from the love of God. I want you to look at this here this morning. See, God walks with us through our hardships. He walks with us through our difficult moments. And when the devil says, if God loves you, he wouldn't let you go through this. Why is God doing this to you? Those are questions that come from the enemy and not from God. They are things that comes to try to discourage your faith, that you want to give up and just step aside. But I tell you one thing that I'm confident of in reading those verses, I am persuaded that there is not a man, there is not a person, there is not a system, there is not an organization, there is not the threat of life or death or anything that could happen that can separate me from the love of God. I am his, he is mine, I know who I am, I know in whom I believe, and I'm going to trust my future in his hands. Hallelujah. Come on, give him a big praise. God's worthy of a big praise. Hallelujah. Yes, no other creature, but I want you to look at that. No other creature can separate me from the love of God. Jesus said, of all that's in my hand, I will lose nothing. And that's true. He will lose nothing. But you have the right and the privilege at any time that you want, you can walk out of his hand and you can walk out of his grace. No other creature can separate me, but I can separate myself from God. I can walk away from God. I can turn my back on God and say no to God. But he's provided a guidance for us in every situation of life, regardless of what life brings us. I have a guidance that comes from God in every situation. And God does not always shield believers from the distress and shield them from the disappointments, but rather he supports them in the middle of difficult times that will come up on their life. He doesn't take them away, he lets them go through them. Let's read John chapter 16, verse 33. Jesus said, these things I have spoken unto you. Amen. I've spoken these. I haven't just spoken idle words. I've spoken beneficial words that in me you might have peace. Now, notice he adds this. In the world, you're going to have tribulation. In me, you're going to have peace. In the world, you're going to have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Now, let me tell you something. When God comes into your life and the devil says you can't make it, you're going to lose. You're a loser. You can't overcome this obstacle. You can't overcome this battle. God's there to say, the world will offer you tribulation, but I've come to give you peace. Now, how can you have peace in the middle of the tribulation? I have peace in this knowing I'm in the hand of God and nobody can pluck me out. I know who I am. I know who I belong to. I refuse to give up on my walk with God. I have peace with God that regardless of what the world brings, I'm going to be of good cheer because He has already defeated the world once and He could do it again in me. Hallelujah. See, believers will face tribulation. Believers will face hardships. Those times will come. But they can take comfort in the victory that's in God. Let's notice 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 8 and verse 9. This is Paul describing life. And he said, we are troubled on every side, but we're not distressed. Now, he is letting us know, if you think you're going to get through life without troubles, problems, conflicts that are going to come, it's not going to happen. You're going to have those things. Those are just normal in life. But he said, I've got to tell you this. In the middle of your trouble, in the middle of your conflict, in the middle of your struggles that you're going through and the problems that you're facing, you're never in danger as long as I'm with you. You are not distressed. You're not in danger. You're not in danger because I walk with you and I talk with you. I will guide you. I will lead you. Because the steps of a good man are ordered by God. Then he goes on to say, we are perplexed, but we're not despair. Perplexed means sometimes I get confused. I walk through life and I get confused with what life is bringing me. But in the middle of my confusion, I never become hopeless. Because my hope is in nothing less than Jesus Christ and His righteousness. My trust, my faith is in Him alone. I may be persecuted, but I'm not forsaken. When I'm walking through the trial, when I'm walking through the forest of lies that can be told on you, I'll never give up. I'll hold on because I'm walking through those persecutions, but I'm not forsaken. I may be cast down, but I'll never be destroyed. You could try to beat me down. You could try to lie on me. You could try to do whatever you want to do. But I'm here to tell you this morning that as long as God's hand is under you, you'll never fall. You'll never fail. You'll never be destroyed. Greater is He that's in you than he that's in the world. You have the victory through Jesus. Hallelujah. He's more than an overcomer in you. So Paul describes the hardships of believers. And he says, you're going to endure all of that. You're going to walk through those struggles and come out strong. And God will sustain you during the time of your trials. Let's notice Romans chapter 5, verse 3 through 5. We glory in tribulation, he said, knowing that tribulation works patience. Now, if you were to ask me, do you enjoy tribulation? I'd have to say no. I have to be honest. I don't like the trial. I'm much better like smooth sailing. But smooth sailing doesn't create strength. You got to have battles. You got to walk through wars. You got to walk through difficult times. Tribulation works patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope makes not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in your hearts by the Holy Ghost. So what he is saying to me in all of these words is this: tribulation serves to bring a positive purpose in your life. It comes to bring out a positive purpose in your life. And it helps you as a believer to develop perseverance, and that hope will give you the strength to persevere through any trial that comes against your life. Notice in the book of Psalms, chapter 34, verse 9, many are the afflictions of the righteous. Just because you serve God doesn't mean that you're supposed to go to God and say, God, look, you know who I am. Why are you letting me go through this? You know what? Parents who love their kids let them go through rough times. They don't bail them out of everything comes along. They don't do everything they can to try to shelter and secure them from problems in life. Because what they do when they do that, they never allow that child to develop the strength to become self-secure. And they don't develop the strength to be able to survive during the trials of life. You've got to give them some failures. They've got to make some horrible, horrible mistakes in their life. And when they go through that, you're there to help pick them up, but not to carry them through it. That's not your job. Your job is to make them strong enough to face life. And if you don't create that atmosphere that child will become so dependent upon you that they'll never be able to survive on their own in life. You've got to cut some strings, and you've got to remove yourself from them. Now, the people of God will experience difficulties. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. You're going to experience some difficulties. But God will be in those difficulties, and through those trials, He will use them to develop a greater purpose in your life. And that's what God is trying to do in your life right now. He's trying to do that. He's trying to develop that greater purpose. Now, the second thing is that when you walk with God through adverse situation, you're going to find the peace of God. The peace of God. The peace of God is important. I need the peace of God during the time of trials in my life. I need the peace of God. Challenging times will cause anxiety. Challenging times will cause you to be anxious, and anxiety will rise up in you, and the fear of what am I going to do, and how am I going to make it, and what am I going to do about this, and what am I going to do about that? You know what? Pray without ceasing was our beginning verse. If I've learned the value of prayer, turning over my situation to God and saying, God, I don't understand why I'm here. I don't understand why I'm going through this. I don't understand why my family's facing this. But I will trust you, and I will trust your direction, because the steps of a good man's ordered of God. And I believe that I've tried to serve you, tried to live for you, and I'm going to trust you. God has peace available for every one of us. And serenity from God does not depend upon whether or not our circumstances is improving. It doesn't mean everything is right. It doesn't mean everything is good. It doesn't mean everything is just rosy in our life. But it means, regardless of the circumstances, whether they're improving or whether they're in digression, I'm going to praise the Lord anyway. I'm going to come to the house of God, and I'm going to give God honor, and I'm going to give Him praise. Would you give Him praise here this morning? Amen. See, peace with God comes as a result of our relationship with God. What kind of a relationship do I have with God? Have I built a strong relationship, a strong trust? Can God trust me? See, I say, you know, I'm going to trust God, and I'm just going to turn it over to God. But the question is, can God trust me? See, because this goes both ways. God has an avenue with two-way traffic on it. And God wants you to trust Him. He wants you to be able to rely upon Him, to turn it over to Him and give it to Him and believe that He's working everything out the way it should be. It is a result of our relationship with God. Peace comes when I develop a give-take relationship with God. So our main focus should not be on fixing, God, fix all my problems, take away all my troubles, let me know what life is all about. No, it's when I trust the Lord and recognize that God's provision is going to be there in the middle of the trial. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will not fear evil. None of us want to die. None of us want the fear of death. None of us want the shadow of death put over us. But David said, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I am not going to walk through this valley in fear, because you are with me, and your rod and your staff, they're going to comfort me regardless of what's coming in life. You're there. Thank God for that this morning. Hallelujah. 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 We need to trust the Lord, and we need to recognize God's provision during the middle of our trials. We've got to have gratitude. And our peace will come when we learn to trust God. Am I trusting God with all my heart? Am I trusting God with all my being? I must keep my mind focused upon the things of God. And even during the time of the greatest challenges of life, I've got to say, God is there. God is there. In the smallest areas, the smallest things that really doesn't mean much, the smallest of things, God is there. And I'm so thankful for that. And that's the way I try to live my life. I try to live my life just trusting that regardless of what comes, it's always God. It's always God. And God is doing these things for my protection. And I'm going to believe, and I'm going to trust in God. Here's what the Bible said in Philippians 4, verse 7. The peace of God. The peace of God, the tranquility of God that passes all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. The peace of God. Now, The peace of God which passes. When you're going through a trial in life, and that trial makes absolutely no sense, and you cannot look at the draw the line and add it up and come up with a proper figure. You don't know why it's here. You don't know why you're going through it. You don't know why your friend betrayed you, or you don't know why bad things are happening. Why did this happen? He said, there is a peace of God that will pass anything that you can understand or misunderstand. Trust the peace of God. Find the peace of God. Even when life doesn't make any sense, find the peace of God. And let God keep your hearts and minds through Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's trusting the peace of God. And peace will come when you start trusting Him to provide for you. Notice what Jesus said. I think we read this verse a couple of weeks ago. I don't know whether it's on Wednesday or Sunday. But in Matthew chapter 6, verse 31 through verse 33. Notice this verse. Therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? Now let me ask you this morning, or here this morning. If you got up today and your kids are hungry, and some of you probably brought some hungry kids to church today. You know, we didn't have time. We didn't fix them something to eat. We did this, we did that, and you came. But let's say there's nothing to fix. There's no food anywhere in the house. Can we look at this verse and say, well, don't give any thought about it. No, don't worry about it. Are we going to go back and start worrying and crying about what we don't have? Are we going to go back to the scripture and say, God, I remember a little boy and his mother that was dying and had nothing but one more meal to eat, and they were going to die of starvation. And you sent a prophet to them, and the word of God came, and they believed the word of God. And after that day, the meal never went away, and the oil never, it kept replenishing itself every day. It never vanished away. When I can't trust anything else, get a hold of the word of God. It's a perfect law of liberty. Amen. Get a hold of the word of God and put that word in your heart. And you say, I don't have anything to eat. I don't have anything to drink. I don't have anything, any clothing to put on. And how often have I heard that? Not many times I hear some people say, I don't have anything to eat. But I hear sometimes women, Sheila will say, I don't have anything to wear today. Got two closets completely full of junk. And it's everywhere. And I got nothing to wear. Shirley probably gets up in the morning saying, I can't find a pair of shoes to wear. She only got 69 pair. And you know, that's the way we are. That's the way we do. And we're not talking about wants. We're talking our needs. We're talking about wants. I wanted a bright pink pair. I wanted this. I wanted that. Let me tell you this morning, trust God. Find a scriptural setting that identifies with where you are today and get a hold of that and watch what God did in the past and what God did yesterday. He will still do today and He'll still do tomorrow, because Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said, don't give any thought about that. Why? He said, for your heavenly Father knows that you have need of these things. That word needs a big word. My heavenly Father knows I have need of those things. And I trust God in the most minute things. If I go to the bowling center to bowl somebody, I trust God. I do. I don't go up there. I sit there basically by myself. I sit there and I'm praying all the time. I'm praying, God, don't let me make a fool out of myself. God, don't let me make a fool out of myself. God, help me. And you know what? He does. He shows up in the most minute, minor things in life. He's not concerned just with the big things. He's concerned with the little things. No matter how small it is, if it concerns you, it concerns God. Get a hold of God. And so he said, the Lord knows what you need. He knows that you need these things. So he said, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these other things, they will be added unto you. I never look at that verse that I don't remember. Back in the 70s when I preached the commencement service at the high school, I think it was the first graduating class at the high school, that was my verse. And the superintendent said, preach. I don't want you to come and talk. I want you to preach. Well, that suited me just fine, because that's all I knew how to do was preach. Amen. And so I went there and I preached. at that first graduating class. I don't know whether anybody heard it. I don't know whether anybody remembered it, but I remembered it. Seek first the kingdom. And that's what I challenged every one of those students to do. Always remember God first. And if you do, everything you need in life will be added to you because God promised that. Go by the promises of God. Jesus reminds us to trust his provision. Rather than worrying about life's needs, trust in the provision of God. Amen. Come on up. You know, if God can send, when Elijah was in a time, it had not rained for 3 years and 6 months. That's a long drought. There had not been one drop of rain. Heard him talking this morning that we'll go down in history this month as the driest October ever in the history of Kentucky. We have less than 1/10 of an inch of rain. In fact, we just have 1/20 of an inch of rain that has fallen the entire month. And they said, we don't have any in sight. So it's going down as that. Well, I remember this guy in the Bible. It didn't rain for 3 years and 6 months. The cattle are dying because they can't eat. The animals are dying because there's no food. There's nothing growing. There's no water to drink. And God said to Elijah, said, go down to the brook. Now, what good is it to go down to the brook? Because down in every brook now, there's nothing there but dried rocks. But go on down there. And Elijah questions God a little bit about it. And God said, go down to the brook. And he goes down to the brook, and there's a little stream of water just enough for him. And it's coming up. You know what he did? Immediately, he began to kind of question God. You know, God, I haven't eaten lately either. And God said, well, I can take care of that. And God sent the birds to bring him fresh meat. And they brought fresh meat to him. Let me tell you something. God will take care of his own if you'll trust him and you'll rely upon him and depend upon him and you'll say yes to God. God will be there for your life. Amen. He'll be there for your life. He has what you need to make your life work right. He has exactly what you need. And God encourages us to place our burdens upon him. He encourages every one of us. Bring our burdens to the Lord. We used to sing an old song, bring your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. And I'm telling you, there's something about some of those old songs that were written by some old songwriters that had experienced that, Amen. And they will sustain. God will sustain you. God will provide for you. God will be there for you. He promised me, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. So I'm going to, in the middle of my trial, I'm not going to take time to look around at the trial. I'm going to focus my eyes upon Jesus. Look into Jesus, the author and the finisher of my faith. I'm going to fix my eyes on Jesus rather than my circumstance. I'm going to see the positive of what God can bring rather than my circumstance. I'm going to say, yes, God, I can do it. I can make it. I'm more than an overcomer through you. I have victory through you. I'm bringing down the power of adversity. I'm submitting myself totally over to you. I'm fixing my eyes upon Jesus. And I'm going to trust in him. See, we're not aware of the purpose that God has set us in this trial for. I'm not aware of what the outcome is going to be. But I'm believing the outcome is going to be for my best. I'm believing that. I have to believe that. Now this morning, honestly, outside of the sickness, and they're not sick, so I'm thankful. Outside of my children, a couple of them having some bad situations, I really couldn't ask for life to be any better. I've got a wonderful God. I got a beautiful church family. I'm still alive and strong and able to do things. I still have a little bit of a mind. And I get to draw from that the resources of God and let those resources become a part of my life. And I trust that in any adversity that may come, God is going to see me through it. So how am I going to do that? I'm going to pray without ceasing. I'm going to keep going to God. And in all things, I'm going to give thanks. I'm not going to give God thanks for Dwayne having cancer again. I'm not going to give God thanks for that. But I'm going to give God thanks because I know the potential that he can bring him through it. I'm going to give God thanks because today he is alive and feeling good and doing well. I'm not going to give God thanks because Jeremy is struggling with some major health issues. But I'm going to give God thanks because I know that my God reigns in the middle of the trial. He's still alive. He's still well. There's nothing too hard for my God. As we stand together in this building this morning, I'm going to give you an opportunity to come to the Lord. Whoever you are, whatever your need is, come now. Come on. They're going to sing. The altar is open. I want to invite you to come and let's pray. Oh God, give us strength. Give us courage. Yes. I love this girl right here. I want some women to know how to pray, to get up here, and I mean really pray with her. Come on, let's get up here right now with her, and let's pour our heart out to God. That's a sweetheart right there. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, come on. Oh, yes, Jesus is mine. Is there anybody else here this morning that you've got a need?
He's been my boatman in the fire, time after time.
Okay, let's have a few folks come here and pray. Just pray for courage. Pray for strength. Pray for great faith. Come on. Come on, guys. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Oh, yes. This is my story. This is my story. Yes. I trust in God. He will never leave us. He will never fail us.
He will never fail.
Oh, mighty God, I love you and I honor you and I thank you this morning. I thank you for the day that you have given us, all the benefits of Calvary. I give you praise for that, oh God. Glory be to Jesus.
Perfect submission.
Perfect submission.
And all is at rest.
God is at rest.
I know the author of
God, I thank you this morning.
So ordered my steps. So this is my story.
Oh, yes. Yes, yes, yes.
And this is my
in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, in the name that's above every name, may the power of the Holy Spirit of God come and rest upon us in the power of your might. May the glory of your eternal Spirit awaken within us, God. That anointing, that Spirit, that power. Yes, God, quicken your Spirit within us. Let the life of the Holy Ghost to become all we need. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, I trust in God.
I trust in God, my Savior.